Good evening. We'd like to call the Durham City Council meeting to order at 7 p.m. Monday, August the 17th, and certainly want to welcome all of you that are here with us this evening. If we could just take a moment for silent meditation, please. Thank you. We'll ask Councilman Brown if he would lead us in the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Madam Clerk, would you call the roll, please?
Mayor Bell.
Present.
Mayor Pro Tem Cole McFadden.
Present.
Councilmember Brown.
Here.
Councilmember Cotati.
Here.
Councilmember Davis.
Here.
Councilmember Moffitt.
Here.
And Councilmember Shule.
Here.
All right, thank you. Are there any announcements by members of the council? If not, we are entertaining priority items by the city manager.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Good evening, everyone. This evening I have one priority item, which is agenda item number 24. It is a supplemental item, and it is a resolution titled A Resolution in Opposition of Redistribution of Local Sales Tax.
Thank you. You've heard the city manager's priority item. Entertain a motion.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? You close the vote?
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. City Attorney.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. No priority items.
Likewise, recognize City Clerk.
No items, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. We'll move to the agenda. Consent agenda being first, and again, if an item is pulled by either a member of the council or the public, we'll discuss that later in the program. Otherwise, consent agenda can be approved by a motion and second of the council members. Item one on the consent agenda is grants management performance audit June 2015. Item two is renewal of Durham City County interlocal cooperation agreement for inspections for a five-year renewal. Item three is the 2014 Durham Environmental Affairs Board annual report. Item four is the 2014 Durham Open Space and Trails Commission annual report. Item five is the 2014 Appearance Commission annual report. Item six can be found on the general business agenda. Item seven is a resolution providing approval of a financing by the Housing Authority of the City of Durham for Maureen Road Apartments for purposes of Section 147F of the Internal Revenue Code. Item eight is grant agreement for sidewalk and bike lane construction on Carpenter Fletcher Road, TIP number U4726HO. Item nine is grant agreement for sidewalk and bike lane construction on Cornwallis Road, tip number U4724. Item 10 is grant agreement for construction of bicycle and pedestrian facilities on Hillendale Road, tip number U4726HK. Item 11 is grant agreement for sidewalk and bike lane construction on Maureen Road, tip number C-4928. Item 12 is transit amenities installation and repair contract. Item 13 is proposed condemnation of property located at 3810 Page Road, parcel ID 158077, for the Southeast Pressure Zone Project. Item 14, superseding of 2014-2016 job-driven national emergency grant project ordinance number 14672 and approval of the Fifth Amendment to Workforce Investment Act contract between the City of Durham and Educational Data Systems Incorporated. Item 15 is revision to city code and fee schedule for towing regulations. Item 16 is stationary container rental contract between the City of Durham and Waste Industries, LLC. Item 17 is strap tire disposal recycling service contract between the City of Durham and Central Carolina Holding, LLC. Item 19 is an item that can be found on the general business agenda. Items 20 through 21 are items that can be found on the general business agenda as public hearings. Entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda item.
So moved.
Second. It's been properly moved and seconded. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? And close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Move to the general business agenda. Item 6, approval of contract for consulting and technical assistance engagement between the City of Durham and Enterprise Community Partners, Inc.
Mayor Bell, members of council, Reginald Johnson, Director of the Department of Community Development. As was discussed at the work session, this is an item that provides technical assistance for the City of Durham through Enterprise Community Partners of Maryland. As we discussed at the work session, there was a request for us to add to the work scope of work an analysis and recommendations on how to formulate a rental program for downtown Durham. We've worked with the consultant, and they've added this scope of work to the contract. We've had a chance to work with them on the time frame as well, and we're comfortable with the scope of work as well as the cost that's incurred, which is another $24,000, which brings the total cost for this phase one to $101,000. And we recommend approval.
Some questions. I don't know if members of the council, but I'll go ahead and proceed with my questions. First of all, I appreciate the administration's proposal to move forward in terms of trying to develop a program. And I had a few questions relative to Task 3, which is the new part that we're talking about, the Downtown Durham Rental Assistance Program. And I guess one of my questions is, under one, data analysis of the downtown Durham market. One of the things that they're going to propose to do is assess the current downtown populations as compared with overall city population to identify subgroups that may be currently underrepresented in the downtown market. And I guess I need to understand what's the rationale behind that?
Mayor Bell, we have with us Ms. Karen Lotto from Enterprise Community Partners. I'm going to let her take the podium to respond to that question.
Mr. Mayor, Council, pleasure to be here today. So, Mr. Mayor, if I understand correctly, the question is, what's the rationale behind the demographic analysis? So the rationale for this was to understand and be able to target more clearly the population that we're actually trying to encourage to move downtown. We need to know who lives there and who doesn't live there in order to determine who we're targeting with the program.
I have some questions about that.
Yes, sir.
I can respond to that. And then item A says potential target populations, 2 to 4 potential target groups will be considered based on a citywide housing need analysis. What is that all about?
So what we're proposing to do is to take a look at what the overall housing needs are in the market, what has been articulated by you and others as the policy priority for downtown, and to pick between 2 and 4 groups. And this would be groups that differ primarily probably income, from an income perspective, whether we're talking 50% to 60% AMI, 60% to 80% AMI, 80% to 100%, we would break those groups down with DCD. We may also look at different household composition. Are we talking singles? Are we talking couples? Are we talking people with children? Pick 2 to 4 of them and really model the program, look at how the program works for these different demographic groups, because a lot of the program will be the same regardless of which demographic group you serve. Some aspects of it will differ, in particular how much of the subsidy there is, how much subsidy is required, and to some extent which units we think people will target depending on their household composition.
The time frame for concluding this project is December 2015 to January 2016, and I guess I'd like to have a better understanding of that in terms of what we can expect from this project.
So the time frame for completing this particular task of the engagement is mid-January 2016. And we base that time based on how long we think it's going to take us to do the work and really considering other commitments that we have to other engagements that we need to get done in the same time frame, and the reality that the holidays, you know, they always slow you down no matter how hard you tried not to have them do that. That is just the time frame for this particular component. There are three other tasks in the contract. I didn't know if you wanted me to speak to all three of those.
No, I'm just particularly interested in the rental assistance program. That's the one that was added on.
Yes, and so we would anticipate, and by the completion date, that would be the date that we actually deliver the written document that would outline the overall program design.
Can you tell me what do you mean in terms of delivery? I saw somewhere in there that you're going to deliver a memo.
We would deliver two things. The first is an actual written description in a memo or a report or whatever we want to call it. And the second would be a high-level presentation, like a PowerPoint presentation that we could then go over with you or that others could then use to discuss the program with other stakeholders.
Are there any plans to present status reports on your work between the time you start and the time you complete it?
We are anticipating, and I would defer to Mr. Johnson, but we are anticipating that we will be providing regular status reports on the overall engagement, whether that's weekly or biweekly with the department remains to be finalized. But Rachel, do you want to?
We expect to, Mayor Bell, be receiving at least biweekly reports.
Okay, I hope we build that in. And again, my focus is on task three. And I would hope that we would see some type of status reports since you're talking about almost a five-month period, at least two or three times within that time frame. But let me go back to where I am relative to this proposal, because I think we're overthinking this. I think we're making it a lot more complex than it needs to be. I think the time frame is unrealistic. I think you ought to be able to do this certainly within 90 days. And so for that, I'm going to go back to what I raised in terms of what we were hopefully going to gain out of this. We've defined the target area. It's downtown Durham. And the staff has presented the outline for that. We've also said that we've defined the target. We want to look at families that are 60 to 80% below the median income. So when you talk about finding groups, we know what we're trying to do. I don't see the value of looking at the demographics downtown, what's down there. I mean, I think that's a waste of time. We already have the product in the makings. We've got luxury apartments already downtown. We have some that are on the drawing boards that are coming out. So the value of who's living downtown, is in the, that doesn't make any difference to me right now. What I'm concerned more about is persons in that category that we define, 60 to 80% below the median income, have the opportunity to rent one of those apartments downtown with certain criteria. So I think it's a waste of time to go through and talk about who's living downtown, what the demographics are. That to me is a waste of time for what I think the goal is. The next piece is I've tried to be very, very specific in terms of what the targets and what the goals are of this program are. I've sent emails to council members. I've sent emails to the staff. And I just want to go over them again and just remind us of how that fits in. Again, the target is 60 to 80% of families living in Durham below the median income. I don't care where they live. I want them living in the city of Durham. What I've suggested is that we put some kind of time frame on how long they've been living there. I don't want a program that's going to attract people to Durham to get into this program. I think people need to have had an invested interest in this, in the program, in the city. And, you know, I think 5 years might be a reasonable time frame. Again, that's for you guys to come through. And the only reason I say five is because the target population that I think we're looking at are people who are making public employee salaries, maybe teachers, maybe policemen, that range. That doesn't necessarily mean it's got to be those people. That's what we're looking at. We're also looking at people that are working. They have an income. I know it's unrealistic to think if we look at apartments that are downtown, where it's basically a one and two bedroom apartments, that you're going to be getting families that you're going to get five people going into a one bedroom apartment. You might get five people going into a two bedroom apartment. I think, again, that's what you all work out. Now, I'm going to give you some numbers here, which shows how I targeted that. The other part of that is, to me, when you talk about rental gap, and we're talking about providing that from the city, that's pretty easy to do. It's really pretty easy to do. And I just want to go back to some numbers, and I'm going to use the numbers that I sent to you guys earlier. And I'm going to thank Councilman Moffitt, because he had an original table. I modified it. Then he came back this evening and modified it again to make it more readable, and I appreciate it, Don, and I know he sent it out to all the people. And basically what he did, he took as an example two apartments. He looked at West Village for a one-bedroom apartment. He looked at what the monthly rent was at for that. It was about $1,420. He took a two-bedroom apartment, which is at 605 West, and he looked at the monthly rent for that. It was $1,960. And so when we look at persons, and again, we've got to understand who's defining the median income. And he has a number here. We get it from the census and metropolitan statistics. And it gets skewed a little bit because Chapel Hill is a part of that, as well as Durham. So I think our median income is higher for that region. It might not be the same for Durham. So that's another piece that I think you all can look at. But it's not going to take 90 days to do that. So if we just take, for example, what he's determined the median income. The median income for a family that's at 100% is $47,200 for one person. For two people, it's $54,000. For three persons, it's $60,000+. For four persons, it's $67,000+. That's a family of four. And of course, you can go on up to five, six, seven, eight. But realistically, if we're talking about those apartments, it's probably unlikely you're going to get larger families than families of four persons. I don't know what a family looks like. It could be a wife and a husband, two kids. It could be whatever makeup, but just look at those numbers. So if you look at those area medium incomes, and then you look at what's 80% and what's 60%, you have those numbers. Mm-hmm. And now if we use the rule of thumb that no more than 30% of a person's mm-hmm. annual income should go towards rent, that tells us how much rent those families can afford.
Right.
And I'm saying this to you, and I know you know it, but I'm saying it also for the record and for those that don't understand what we're talking about. And again, we're saying 30%. It's Durham's program. We might want to make it 40%. Since we're talking about persons that are closer to 80%, we might want to make it 40%. Again, that's a call that I would think you all would come up and tell us. So let's take an example. If you look at West Village, where there's a one-bedroom apartment, for persons who are in 80% income, 80% of the average medium income, if you looked at what it would cost for them to move into a one-bedroom apartment in West Village and how much they can afford to pay, the gap is $476. If you look at that same one-person apartment, for the 60% person who's making less, the gap would be $712. So, you know, a rule of thumb for us might be we don't want to contribute any more than, say, $600 to this thing. So that would rule out this person who is at 60% and wants to live in a one-bedroom apartment in West Village. But now if you look at that same apartment where you've got two persons, the gap goes from $476 to $340 that we would have to provide. And if by chance you could find a family of three persons that wanted to live in a one-bedroom apartment in the West Village, the gap would be $206. That could be a family with one kid or whatever. I don't know what it is, but that's what we're looking at. And if you looked at, it's $206 for 80%, it would be $510 for 60% person. If that same family at 80% had four persons, the gap would be $72. Now, we don't know if we can get a family of four living in a one-bedroom apartment. That's where it goes. Likewise, you can go down to a two-bedroom apartment where it gets to be a bit more expensive. And it looks like if we say we don't want to spend any more than $600, I say $612, there would be only one case where you would have a family of four persons that wanted to live in a two-bedroom apartment, and we'd have to make up $612 for that person. So you can go through that, but the point is there are really only six points, that if this council decided they didn't want to spend any more than $612 for this per family for this, that would qualify. So you've pretty much narrowed the pool. Now, it doesn't take a lot of rocket. You haven't got to go out and survey anybody. You haven't got to go out and do anything. All you've got to do is announce the program. And I'm not saying how to announce the program. You can work with, you know, people at Durham Housing Authority. You can work with developers and say, we've got this rental assistance program where if the family meets this criteria, and you may put some other criteria in there, then we could cover the gap. You don't have to have a lot of study for that. Let me finish. You don't have to have a lot of study for that. So that's the outline of the program. Now, where I think the real issue comes is how do we monitor that program? And what is it going to take to do that? Who's going to go out and find these families? Who's going to certify these families? What kind of criteria are we going to have that a family that's at 80% and suddenly 6 months from now they're at 100%, and do they still qualify to live? And that's the kind of details that I would expect you all to work out. But you don't need to do a study. You haven't got to talk about subgroups. Again, in my opinion, you don't have to talk about subgroups to meet the criteria that I'm laying out. 60 to 80% living in Durham, residents of Durham, having lived there a certain amount of time, being able to verify their income. That's another piece that you all will come back and say, how are you going to verify that Bill Bell is really making what he says? Mm-hmm. Is Bill going to have to show you my income tax since I'm working? I mean, you all work that kind of detail out. But for me, it doesn't take from September to January or February to develop that type of program that I'm looking at. And I think it can be done in less time than you're proposing if we're dealing with the type of issues that we have here. And I'm just going to remind the council, my colleagues, that this doesn't preclude any other incentives that developers may want to make to do affordable housing. We just passed a thing that the planning department presented to us where, and I don't call them incentives. I don't call them incentives. I call them concessions, because they're concessions to developers. They become incentives, in my opinion, when you start giving developers money. The program that the staff came up with doesn't require the city to give anybody. It gives them a concession, gives developers a concession. You can build if you want to build market rate houses, if you can build three, and if you want to build an additional one, then you get the concession of not having to do the parking and all those. That's a concession. The incentives is when we put money into this 26-story tower that's going to be built. An incentive is when we put money into 21C, an incentive when we put money into hotels, an incentive when we put money into some of these industrial areas that we're working with. So we have concessions right now. And it's in my opinion that concessions aren't going to work until we put in that other piece about what does affordable housing mean in terms of income. And I know the staff says they're going to tweak it, but Mr. Manager, I think you need to get that done pretty quickly, because nobody's going to pay attention to that until they know exactly what am I going to get from these people that are going into affordable housing. But the point I was making, we've adopted a program already, and we haven't said anything about how we're going to monitor it. We just adopted it. The other piece is we're already doing basically what I'm suggesting. We're doing it right over in Rolling Hills, where you've got a mixed income development, where 140 plus units, Red, you can tell me better, 140 plus units, I guess, units are there. As I understand it, all of them have been rented with the exception of three, and the ones that haven't been rented are the market rate apartments. But the people who are 80%, 60%, 30%, they've occupied that. And the only way we're able to do that is because we put money into the project, which allowed the developer to charge the lower rents. So we're already doing that. We're doing it right over here on South Street in our home ownership program. We set a criteria. We said no more than 50% of those houses can go to people with market rate above. The rest have to be below that. And we're already going through that criteria now. So we're doing it. It's not like we're reinventing the wheel. We're just taking a little bit different tact here, which HUD does, which DHA does, and a lot. And you know, I've heard that there are a lot more programs around the country that are doing this thing. Maybe you can find them. Maybe you can tell them to what we have. But my point is, it doesn't take, in my opinion, the time that you've got listed here to do what I'm suggesting we ought to be able to do. It just doesn't take it. So I'm ready to have more conversation on it, but I'm not comfortable with spending this kind of money to develop this type of program and do all the things that you're talking about doing, which I don't think are needed. And it's taking your time, taking staff time, when you can be better focusing on trying to deal with these things here. And again, don't pay attention to the tone of my voice.
No, absolutely. Okay. I understand your concern about getting this done. I come at this from the perspective of how do I, to the entire council, bring a solid policy recommendation that the council can act on. And I think I want to kind of raise a couple of questions, which is, we've targeted 60 to 80% area median income, but if, for example, because we haven't looked at the numbers, if, for example, in fact, within the next ring neighborhoods in Durham, you know, the next ring, you know, you have downtown, and then you have the rings right around downtown.
No, no,
sir,
no,
may I please? Well,
I just want to make sure we're talking about the city that we've defined.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, the city of Durham. So within the next ring, we have a superabundance of housing affordable to households at 60 to 80% area median income. I heard a concern at the work session about is 60 to 80% really the place we want to be spending our money. The council has adopted a resolution that has said that in the transit corridors, and downtown is one of the transit corridors, that the target, that the focus is getting 15% affordable under 60% of area median income. So that was the part of us saying we really need to take a step back and think about what is the appropriate target demographic. The other side of this is I hear a great deal of concern from you about bringing families, which could just be, you know, couples or could be families with children. It depends on how we define family. But if in fact we are not seeing families with children, if that's the target group downtown, then why do we think that low-income households or lower-income households are going to move downtown just because you subsidize them? There are other reasons why families with children may or may not choose to live downtown. Is the program going to meet your policy goal?
Let me respond to that. I'm trying to be clear again. The target is families that income is between 60 and 80%, okay? And I've already said that in some cases, I don't care how you constitute a family. I mean, we know families get constituted different ways now.
Mm-hmm.
But depends on the numbers. The point is that the people who own these apartments now, they're already dealing with that.
Right.
They're already dealing with that. They're the ones that would be, that the person would come in and give the application to, and they go through whatever financial checks that they have to go through to determine if this person is financially able to move into this apartment. If somebody comes in with six people, I doubt very seriously if they're going to be able to rent that apartment. So I'm not trying to force anything on developers. I'm just trying to say, give these same persons who are 60 to 80% the same opportunities that someone is at a market rate or above to move into these places. You might find market rate people there above that don't have families, or that do have families. And they choose to move there because they can afford it and because the developer will let them in. So that isn't an issue for me. I don't think we need to be getting, and the point that you made about less than, again, I'm talking about downtown.
Right.
I'm talking, and so if you got places where affordable for persons that are living, that's fine. I'm not trying to take, I'm trying to focus on these new units that are going downtown.
Mm-hmm.
And the only reason they're going downtown is because we've made the public-private investments to help build up downtown. That's what I'm focusing on. So it's not a question of, well, so you got another group of people who already live in downtown, you know, do we want it? No, I don't care about that. If they're living there, fine. I just spoke to a young lady that's living on 605 Chapel Hill.
Mm-hmm.
She pays $1,250 a month for rent. I didn't get into asking her what her income was or anything like that. I know her. I suspect how she got in there. But she's paying $1,250 a month for a one-bedroom apartment at 605 Chapel Hill Street. Now, granted, those apartments come furnished. I mean, that's up to the tenant whether they want to keep it. They come furnished, but they live in there. And I asked her about how many other people do you think are living there. She gave me some number. But that wasn't an issue for me. The fact is that she's there, and I think we ought to afford the same type of opportunities for some of the other apartments. The other piece is I've taken numbers that my colleague provided in terms of rent for these apartments. You know, there may be apartments that rent for less.
Right.
And I just showed you one. 605, a one-bedroom apartment is $1,250 a month. whereas in West Village, a one-bedroom apartment is 1420. Mm-hmm. So it's higher. So what it means for me is that you might find more people that are qualified to go into that apartment, and also might mean that we pay less. The other piece is going to be up to the council to decide how much of that revenue stream that we're getting from that penny tax, $2.4 million, that they want to invest in this. You know, they may decide we don't want to spend any more than $100,000. That's the council call. And, you know, just like it's going to be supply and demand, we run into the same problem that the Durham Housing Authority runs into with its vouchers. They have a lot of people that qualify. The point is they're limited in terms of the amount of dollars. And we're not going to be any different than that. But at least someone would have gotten into the door. And I don't want anybody to be put off about the fact that my example showed 100. All that I was trying to do is to indicate that if the council took the upper level of the gap, which is $600 a month, 12 months, for one person, that's $7,200. Mm-hmm. If you took 10 people, that's $72,000. If you had 100 families paying that, it would be $720,000. That's all I was using as an example. But I think if you look at this latest piece, we're going to be limited in how much we put out in there. And I'm suggesting that maybe the limit might not be any more than $610 mm-hmm. per family. So again, let's have a conversation, because I'm trying to make sure we get on the same page and understand where we are on this.
No, I go ahead.
I want to finish.
No, but that's, I'm happy to hear from Councilman Shule.
All right, recommend, listen to Councilman Shule. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So I appreciate your passion, Mr. Mayor, and recognize its genuineness. And just a couple things. So I think we're talking about the difference between 90 days and 150 days. You know, we're talking about 2 months difference in the time.
You want to tell me why I'm concerned about that?
Yeah.
I would like this council to make the decision, okay? In January, we don't know who's sitting here. You could have four other people sitting here, theoretically. And you could have two or three other people here. I don't want to go through the same discussion over again. I would like this to be a decision that the council makes and moves on. Now, if a new council comes and wants to wipe it out, that's their call. But I would like this council to make the decision as to whether or not we move forward and how we move forward. The program, if we implement it, is always going to be tweaked. I know that. I mean, we do some things and we say, oh, we can change it. But I don't want to be starting over scratch trying to educate a totally new council on this project. So that's why the 90 days becomes important to me. Aside from the fact, I really think it can be done in 90 days based on what we're asking for. But go ahead.
Well, okay, so I can understand that, but I guess let me just predict with confidence that you will be sitting here in 90 days, Mr. Mayor, and I'm planning to be too, and so I hope that it won't be totally new. But I understand your point. I just don't think it overrides the point that we have, you know, there's a scope of work here, and it includes this task, and there are other tasks that I think are really important that go along with it, which is to help build an affordable housing strategy. And it's not just this one simple task. I'm not against it in any way. I'm happy to see this being studied, and I appreciate the passion with which you've attacked it, really. I do think there are a lot of issues to be worked out. I think that the monitoring issue that you mentioned is really tricky. You know, people move a lot when they rent, and I know that there's a big monitoring task in Chapel Hill that they do just for the home ownership that is subsidized, just trying to trace those people's, you know, monitor that. You're talking about people in potentially a bunch of different apartments with new owners coming and going, with renters coming and going. And I think that it can be done, but I appreciate the fact that I think it needs some time to think it out well. And also think that, you know, the transit resolution says 60% are below the area median income. We all voted for it. So I think that thinking about what the target group is and the right target group makes perfect sense. So to me, giving that some study seems important. So I would just say I'm happy to support this, and I'm happy to support this at the addition of this. But I don't see what I think that, to me, if the consultant in the department think it's going to take 5 months and not three, I respect that, and I'm happy to go with it.
Again, based on what they want to do, I don't think they need to do all that. That's the bottom line. I don't think that all needs to be done. The other piece about on top of, I made it very clear that I'm not trying to impact the original study. I asked very clearly, what would it take to do this part? I didn't say stop what you're doing. I said, what additional resources will be required to look at a real census program? And that's what they came back with, and that's what we're paying them for. And the other piece about the transit stop, 60% below is fine. This doesn't impact that. The thing I would say about the, I chair the Transit Authority Board, so I understand well the transit program. We aren't gonna know for sure where those transit stops are until probably another year. By the time it gets through the feds and gets, we aren't gonna know that. Meanwhile, apartments are still going on, apartments are existing, and an opportunity, in my opinion, would be lost to wait for what's gonna happen on transit stop. I mean, we said transit stops. What we should have said is a definite transit stop, because we don't know where those transit, we know what's proposed. I know what's proposed. All of us know what, whether it happens or not, I don't know. So that's not gonna impact the target group that I'm speaking specifically to, right, in terms of existing apartments and new apartments that will be going up in the downtown area, which has been defined by the staff, which does include those circles which the staff has outlined for transit stops. That doesn't affect that. Doesn't affect that at all. Target, again, is existing apartments and new apartments that are coming on board or be coming out of the ground that we would be focusing on. And the limitation is what we want to limit it to. You know, you don't have to spend $720,000 on a project. You don't have to spend $600,000. You might not want to spend $500,000. But that's for a council to decide. And, you know, that's something you might want to phase in over a period of time to see how it's working, what you're able to get from that. Councilman Moffitt.
So I understand the frustration. I've seen, along with everybody else here, downtown develop. I've seen housing costs at Cleveland Holloway, just takes my breath away. It's a downtown, and not, it's not necessarily downtown, but it's very close in. And I see a lot of potential benefits from the program, Mr. Mayor, that you're suggesting, but I also see a lot of potential pitfalls. And the devil is in the details. There's a lot of details to be worked out. If this is to become a program that I can support, what I don't want to do, we're talking about hundreds of thousands of dollars annually. And what I don't want to do is to rush a process that winds up with a lot of repair work required. It's not typical for the council to get into the details of writing the policies. I have often said to people that the city of Durham does great work, but never quickly. And that's because the staff is very methodical, very careful, and makes sure that when they put a program in front of us, that it's a program that's designed for long-term success. So I don't know yet, there are many, many, many details yet to be determined. So to me, there's no program to support or not support. Conceptually, I see the possibilities and the potential, but I get very nervous when we talk about rushing the staff and the consultants to do a specific program. So I caution patience and you know, methodical establishment of a program if we move forward with this. Thank you.
John, I'm going to recognize Councilman Brown, but I need to comment when these things come up. Again, the timetable that we've been presented with includes work that hasn't been proven to me needs to be done. I mean, I don't know why you've got to study the demographics of downtown Durham. I just don't understand why you got to spend time studying that. I don't know why you've got to spend time studying who are in these two groups. In fact, I really don't know how you're going to do it. That's fluid also. How are you going to determine how many people are making whatever the income? Let the market determine that. You develop the program, you present it, and if people are interested, they'll come forward. And if we've got the criteria, that's the big part about it, developing the criteria that we want to carry forth. Not studying how many people live downtown or demographics of how many people live downtown or who are in these subgroups. That isn't it. You know, how do you pay it? That's important. How do you monitor it? That's important. How do you manage it? That's important. But that, to me, doesn't take, you know, 6 months to do. It really doesn't. I don't understand that. And that's why, again, I said, independent of what we do, I want to see more frequent reports coming to this council so we can say, okay, we think you're headed in the right direction or you aren't. And the other problem is, once we lock in, I don't want to have to be paying for additional work, because it's very clear in this document that they deliver this, and anything above that, we're going to have to pay for. And I have an issue with that. Councilman Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And I appreciate your comments as well as my colleagues. I guess I would suggest that really none of us up here are talking about a rush to judgment with this program. We had a former colleague up here, Howard Clement, who on occasion was fond of talking about the paralysis of analysis. And in all candor, I think certainly part of what the mayor is suggesting may be a paralysis. In my judgment, we should determine a couple of things. Number one, the $2.4 million of the penny for housing, how much of that do we as a council want to dedicate to the rental program? That's a very important decision, and one that will, in the short and long run, help determine where some of these citizens end up living. West Village, for example, is probably the most expensive of all the apartments that have been recently constructed. But we need to look at more than just rent, because as I mentioned at the work session, folks, some of these apartments and the complexes are really hurting for tenants. And they're offering, call it an incentive or a concession or whatever. Usually they do not go down on the amount of the rent, but they will offer 1 or 2, in some cases 3 months rent for free. So that's really an important component of this. I would also suggest that we look at what's normally called best practices. Who else is doing throughout the country, or certainly the Southeast, programs such as what we're talking about this evening? And I mentioned again at the work session that some cities definitely have a targeted program for police officers, some for teachers, in order to encourage them to not to live in Nightdale, as some of our officers do, which I think is just absurd. But this is the sort of thing that we need to also consider. Very simple, best practices. When you're talking about families, you cannot dismiss the issue of schools. Where would the families who are end up in some of these apartments? What are the, very simple question, what school district are they in? And what options do they have in terms of magnet schools and so on? Another issue is that who's going to implement this program? I don't think that DHA, the Durham Housing Authority, wants to do this. So how much and how many, can one person do this on city staff? Or will it take more than that? Again, that's why I'm strongly suggesting a plan that will be done incrementally, not a big rush just at the beginning, because this, I don't want to overemphasize this, but this, you know, it's not an easy task. to do this and to do it correctly. So I think these are just some of the issues that we need to address, because it should be not the consultant's decision, obviously, but the council's decision in terms of how much money are we going to set aside for the rental program. And if you begin with that, then that can give you an idea, realistically, probably of how many families that that we as a city can afford to host in this program. That's just a few of my thoughts, Mr. Mayor. Thank you.
Thank you, Gene. And again, I don't disagree with any of the comments that you made. No, seriously don't. I've said from the start, it's going to be the council's decision as to how much of that revenue we want to spend on this program. It's always the council's decision. I've agreed that it's going to be administrative costs. And I don't know how many people it's going to take to implement the program, but that's what the consultants, that's the part of the job that I think they come back and recommend. We accept it or we don't accept it, but I don't want to get into that level of detail. That's what I'd like the consultant to do. Again, if they're, and I heard them say earlier, there are programs across the country, and I don't have a problem with barring something that's good. I suggested to Durham Housing Authority simply because they are here. And we understand they deal with a population much more extensive than the population I'm speaking about. But they do have guidelines. And, you know, those guidelines might apply to us or they might not. We've been talking about 30% income. No more than that. No more than 30% of these families' income should go towards rent. You know, it's up to us to decide that. You know, it may be that if you're making 80%, maybe you ought to be able to pay 35%, which means that it's less cost to the city, but it's more families that you can deal with. And so that's the kind of detail that I would want the consultants to come back with. And again, this is a big company, I've been told. You're all over the country to a certain extent. You've got staff. And I would expect you to rely on that, because initially when I spoke about you, you weren't here, but someone mentioned your name and I said, the young lady and the manager reminded me, it's not just her. She's got a staff behind her. So I accept that. And you were selected for that reason. But again, the time frame, I just think, is too long for what we're asking to do. And I know the program is always going to be tweaked. And just because you implement the program at this level, again, it's up to the council to decide how much they want to bite off of. You come back with a program, and you say, well, council members, you can serve 100 people. We think you can serve 100 people. And if we say that based on where we are, we think you shouldn't spend any more than this number of dollars for a family of one, two, three, or four. And here's what it's going to cost you to do that. If the council says, we accept that, fine. If the council says, no, we want to spend that much money, we want to spend half of that. Then it's very easy to come back and say, okay, if you're going to spend half of it, here's probably the number of families that you can accommodate. But that's a decision that council make, but we make it based on you haven't gone through and given us the details of how the program should work. And again, I'm going to remind my colleagues, we've already accepted a program for the staff for concessions to developers. Now, again, I say concessions, not incentives, to the developer to build affordable housing if they get certain concessions. We didn't say one thing about how we're going to monitor it. Not one thing. We don't know how we're going to monitor it. So, and I don't think that's part of your job. That's not part of your job, but somebody's going to have to come up with that.
So, go ahead. If I may just comment on a couple of points. I think this issue of resource allocation really is a critical one, because we are not talking about This is a zero-sum game in the sense if we have this many resources and they're going to be allocated to all of the purposes that the council has to allocate. In this case, we have this much, you know, penny for housing money to be allocated not just to this program, but to all of the programs that the city wants to do in housing. And so if the council is making a decision how much of the penny for housing should be spent on this program, that's not a decision to be made in a vacuum. It's a decision to be made in spending it on a rental assistance program generates this, spending it on this type of program generates that. It's one thing to say, and there are ways to ease into that by saying we're going to start with a pilot and see how that goes before we make a huge funding commitment. But I think we are very conscious as in our job as advisors to say we have to lay out the alternatives. And then it is the decision of the policymakers to decide which of those alternatives they're going to choose and how much of their resources they're going to dedicate to them. And the second piece I want to note is indeed, as a number of you have noted, the devil is in the details with all of these programs, and that is what starts to make them, you know, gorily painful as you go through the program development, because it's everything from, you know, on the income side, not only how am I going to income certify, who's going to do it, how am I going to count certain income, you know, if they've only been employed for 6 months, if they are, you know, if they're an hourly worker, if the unit, if on the rent side, if their unit, this unit includes utilities, but this one doesn't, how do I weight those two things, you know, next to each other? How do I monitor it before somebody moves in? Who do I pay? Who do I issue the check to? There's just a bunch of decision points that you have to figure out that you have to work through. And you also need to spend some time understanding if there's going to be market uptake. Do the landlords want to deal with this city bureaucracy or that city bureaucracy? And if not, how do we streamline in such a way that they don't have to? So I don't want to undersell the fact that there's, in order to deliver to the city a program that they can act on, that there's just a lot of detail that has to be worked through.
I give you that. I'm not belittling that at all. I'm not belittling that at all. But I'm just saying, to me, it still doesn't take 6 months or 5 months to develop that type of criteria. Mm-hmm. And again, you know, when you talk about how we're going to spend a penny for affordable housing, that's a council decision. Correct. I made it quite clear. The council decided it wants to spend $100,000, wants to spend all of it. That's a council decision. That isn't what we're asking you. What we would be asking you is, after you've developed a program with this criteria, then we can go through and figure out, well, if we got this number of people paying at the extreme, the $600 a month, and that's $720,000, do we want to develop that? No. You might say no, we want to cut it down. So that, again, I think you get into some areas that the council has to make a decision. Again, the details of what we're trying to get you to develop. And I don't want to get in a position where we are playing this program against the whole affordable housing program. That's not where I am, because as I said, if this council is serious about having family, giving families an opportunity to fall in this category that we've defined, to occupy some of these units that are going up in downtown, that's a decision to count. And if we're not serious about that, we just get off the whole thing. But if we're serious about it, let's move forward with a program that will lead us into that. And it's not playing this against the whole affordable housing piece, because I do have some questions about that, but I'm leaving that alone. I'm trying to focus on this additional task that you were getting. Recognize Councilwoman Katar.
Thank you, Mayor. As much as I would like to vote on this before I go off council, I feel very strongly about affordable housing and feel committed to it, and I'm very glad that we passed the penny. I don't think we should be rushing the process. I'm much more interested in the original scope of work, not so much the add-on. I was willing to go along with the add-on. But to me, it's not so much how much we want to spend of our housing penny versus how many people do we want to serve and at what income levels. I much more would prefer to see what options we have to provide affordable housing in a cost-effective manner. That may be using our public land. It may be building affordable units just outside downtown or elsewhere in a community. I'm just not sure at this point, and I don't have enough information, that I want to provide rental assistance to move people downtown to expensive apartments. If we could be building more affordable apartments and getting people in them in the long term, that's something I'd be more interested in. We know that there are probably over 1,500 applicants on the Section 8 voucher waiting for housing. We know there are people in need. Those may not be singles or couples that want to live downtown because it's cool. I mean, we'd all like to live downtown because it's cool, but I'm not sure that's the best use of our affordable housing money, and I really want to see what they can generate, and that we can have that broader discussion about our priorities and what it's going to cost us and what we get for it. Thank you.
Dan, I appreciate that, because I guess the question I've raised still remains on the table. Do we want to look at this section of our city, which is downtown, for persons that fall in this category of income, 60 to 80%? The 1,500 people that you're talking about, I don't know they range from probably 90% down to 30%. And I'm not suggesting that you want to try to fit the program to people who have the 30%. That isn't where this project comes from. And, you know, the other pieces about how do we want to provide affordable housing, that's the scope of the work. I'm not taking away from that. I'm just saying I'm trying to be very targeted in what we're looking at. And again, if the council is of the opinion they don't think that's where we ought to be focusing our attention, that's a council decision. So I'm not playing one against the other. I'm trying to be very specific in the area we're talking about, the families we're talking about, the source of income that we're speaking about, and the fact that we don't have the details which a consultant can develop for us based on what I heard them say. And so what I'm arguing is the time frame to do that. And I'm suggesting that some of the information, some of the work that they're talking about doing doesn't need to be done to do this. It just doesn't, and it takes time. It takes time to do that when they could be spending it more on developing the details of the program. And see, I want to be clear about even what the deliverable is. When I saw a memo, that doesn't mean anything to me. What I wanted to see is a detailed plan of how it will be implemented. And if that's what the memo meant, that's fine, but I just want to make sure that's what we were speaking about. Again, I recognize the mayor pro tem.
I'll be very brief. As you know, I certainly support your vision, Mr. Mayor. And we can intellectualize this issue until midnight tonight, but the bottom line is that we have to have the will to make a difference in downtown. Not only do we need to diversify the population of people who live there, but businesses as well. That's a different issue. But we need to take affirmative action to make change downtown. We have not had this much discussion over affordable housing in other areas of the city. We talked about how much it would cost. So I don't understand the issue regarding downtown. I'd like to be able to live downtown, but I cannot afford it either. But I think we need to not be a part of continuing the segregation downtown. That's a very strong word, but that's exactly what it's beginning to look like. Businesses, black businesses moving out. And so I see nothing wrong. We have no problems giving money for affordable housing to the same people over and over and over again. Let's think outside the box and try to do something different. And we don't have to even look at what other cities are doing. Let us make a difference here and let other cities look at what we're doing. That's all I have to say, Mr. Mayor.
To that point, I can tell you that other cities are looking. The clerk advised me that someone from Massachusetts heard about our proposal and want to understand what we're talking about. I mean, that's in Massachusetts, not in North Carolina. And I've had some other people in cities of North Carolina to talk about it. So Durham is getting to be a beacon for other cities and what we're doing. I mean, I can't count on one hand because it's going to take more fingers, but the point is how many people have come to Durham to look at what we've done. We had a contingency here from Mount Airy, Providence, Rhode Island, Columbia, South Carolina. I can just name a lot of other persons that have come to Durham to see what we're doing. And I can tell you, some are asking also, well, who's living downtown? What kind of people are living downtown? I'm not talking about a program like you got over in Chapel Hill, because I don't think Chapel Hill is the type of program we want, personally. They're reaching a different target. The demographics are different in Chapel Hill than they are here in Durham. So that isn't a program that I would necessarily, and I'm not knocking, I'm saying that's not a program that I'm suggesting we want to try to model our program behind. But I recognize the city manager.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Ms. Lato, could you clarify one thing for us, please? I'm assuming when you developed the scope of services and the costs associated with Task 3, you projected some hours of work for each of the components and the costs associated with that. So could you estimate, since it's not really broken down at that level of detail in Task 3, what the hours or the time frame that you were...
I could, but not at this particular moment, because I did not bring the backup with me.
Okay, so
but I can certainly follow up with you tomorrow.
I'm not trying to belabor. I thought it might be helpful to know how much time or cost would be shaved off the, you know...
In the first task is a trivial activity, the demographic analysis. It's, if I'd have to go back, but it's, you know, on the order of 7 or 8 hours of, you know, max of work. It might not even be that, because that's just a data pull. So that would obviously, it would impact the cost at the margins, but it wouldn't shave significant amount of time off the activity.
So,
the time and the activity is really spent on the development aspects of the different, just the different aspects of the program, getting to understand the housing market, because we do need to understand the product that we're targeting. To understand what are the different rents, what are, you know, what are we going to potentially need to subsidize at different income levels compared to the rent levels, and to get a sense from building owners what would be, or building managers rather, what would be acceptable to them, so that they don't discriminate against participants in this program because they don't like the way the program runs, or they don't like the agency administering the program.
Can I just speak, because the manager raised a good point that I was going to ask in another way, but if, what's the total hours that you had developed for the program, the Task 3?
I could tell you tomorrow, but I can't tell you right now. I didn't bring it with me.
Okay. Fine. That's one point. Again, understand that these families are no different than any other family that wants to come in and rent an apartment. They aren't any different. We aren't trying to take over anything from the developers. The developers, who we want to make sure is they aren't discriminating. That's what we got a human housing people to look at. We make sure that's not happening. But a person goes in and applies for an apartment. He has to fill out a certain form. Some even ask for a criminal background.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's no different. And then, you know, he figures out how much can they pay. And if the family has talked to this group and it meets our criteria, then they'll know how much additional dollars they might be able to have. But they come to find out what the criteria is. Now, you know, the questions you might want to put in there is, are these taxable dollars to the residents when they get it? You know, you throw that in there. Someone asked me when I was at a PAC 1 meeting Saturday. Well, you know, the housing authority gives $900 vouchers. I don't know what he meant, but that's what he said. So can a person, in effect, double dip? Can a person get a voucher from the housing authority and then come get a voucher from the city and then go to the developer? That's what you tell us, okay? I mean, I have my own thoughts about that. That's what you tell us. But again, it's I agree it's in the details, but I also agree that if the other programs that are doing it, if you've got the type of company that I've been led to believe you have, you got the resources to call on, you ought to be able to find those answers quicker than 6 months to do. Mm-hmm. Councilman Davis.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I appreciate the passion. And I appreciate the need to make sure that there is diversity downtown and in other quarters that we have in the city. I also appreciate what I've read about the consultant and the company that will be working with us. But I am a bit concerned about the fact that we want this work to be done between now and the end of the year before the elections and those kind of things. I guess I have a bit more confidence in the smooth transition of government that we have. And I'm hoping that the people of Durham will elect people who will be able to make sound decisions and will be able to help us to make those decisions. And I have no fear of the people who might come and be a, and who would be a part of our decision-making process. So although I understand the need to move as quickly as possible, and maybe some of the things that the consultant might tell us that we may already know, but I have no fear of the folks who will follow the folks who will be departing, and would hope that we would have confidence that they will help us to make those decisions. So I would caution in or err on the side of allowing the council to make solid and methodical decisions. Thank you.
Let me be clear. I don't have a fear. I don't have a fear. I don't have a fear. When I first spoke about this program, it wasn't because of, you know, a potential election coming up. It's because of what I thought personally was a reasonable amount of time to do this project. And I've said again that the other piece that comes in there is, yes, you might have a different council, you may have the same council, and you got to go through this other process. But I just firmly believe that you don't need 6 months to develop this program. Now, again, you got the consultants, the council has to make a decision. The first decision it's got to make is whether or not, in fact, it wants to do the program. And if, in fact, it does want to do the program, do you want to do it under conditions that the consultants have proposed? And if so, we go ahead and move on. So, but it's not fear. So I didn't say fear. You said fear. Okay. I didn't say fear. I've been on this stuff too long to talk about fear. Recognize Councilman Shule. Because I see someone signed up, Thelma Glenn signed up for item six, and I'm not sure what item six is. Oh, it's this one. Oh, okay. All right. I recognize Ms. White. I said Glenn, Thelma White.
Good afternoon, Mayor and City Council. How are you, everyone? I'm here to represent the Emerald Woods Community Association. I am the president, and I stand to support the mayor's proposal and ask the City Council to please support the mayor. Thank you.
Can I ask Councilman Shule? Dr. Allison, I didn't have a card. Okay, all right. You want to speak also? Okay, well, what you should do is go to the podium and ask the clerk for the card. You can just come up in terms of time, just state your name and address, and you can fill out the card later.
Good evening, Mayor, members of council. My name is Frank Meacham, and I have about 35 years of working in housing, particularly low-income families. I see the value in our communities being integrated. Also like the mayor's idea of incentivize the housing. We don't want anything that they can go in there and think they're gonna be in there for a lifetime, as in some other situations. So I know the mayor does his homework, as I have seen on more than one occasion. So I can certainly support his position. Thank you.
If you can just come to the podium, state your name and address, and give the card to the clerk.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of the council. My name is Jarvis Martin, and I'm a resident of 3608 Mossdale Avenue. The area of affordable housing is one that is very dear to me. Personally, I am a person who have worked in this arena for many years. It's not an easy task. This council and other councils has done a lot to move forward this whole effort. But I do support the mayor's position from the standpoint that I do think we need to do something now to diversify the population in downtown. There are a general feeling in this community that the council moving forward is concerned with the development of downtown, but they're not concerned with the livelihood of the total community having the opportunity to benefit and live and enjoy the fruits that we as taxpayers have paid for many of the things that we boast about today and proud to see. I think this is just a step forward. As said, it's not something that has to be put in concrete. is something that can be tweaked over time, and if other things come online that can be replaced, then I know that the council will take the steps. But I do agree that we need to move forward and quit talking, because there is a segment of this community that feels that they are being left behind and not given the opportunity. And when I'm saying that, I'm talking about the people who provide our services. What you're talking about, providing opportunity for some teachers, people who work in public safety, people who serve us when we come downtown to enjoy the benefits, who work as waitresses and other service capacities. So those are the people that I think need to live in proximity or have the opportunity to live in proximity as to where they work. And to me, this is just one small step forward. And yes, the details, the devil's in the details, and this council can work that out. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for this opportunity to be here tonight. I had a privilege of reading an article that was in the Durham News. I was really fascinated, and it encouraged me to come down here tonight. And I probably want to congratulate, thank Mr. Brown. He looks like he might be supporting this idea. That's what it said, and he's getting ready to leave. We leave a positive legacy to do something like this. I was a little concerned about two other people. One is leaving, one is running for mayor before the mayor gets ready to leave. I'm a little concerned. Durham mayor proposes rental assistance program. I've been here watching the conversation between three people on this end ever since I've been here while the mayor was speaking. Very interesting. I'm totally supportive of us doing something different. This is out of the box. Diversity, socioeconomic diversity, having a gap that you can close with folk who can't really afford to be downtown. Downtown is looking real, really good. I've been concerned because Federal Street is not looking as well as downtown. And I hope that these folk who leave it and those who are trying to go to up higher will have the courage to support this. We need out-of-the-box activities in Durham. Downtown is looking very well, but we need some folk living down there who really can't, and I was looking at HUD's medium income and what that means. And they deal with it in terms of one family, two children or two people and so forth. It's all the way up. The median income is $67,400. Who's making that kind of money that looks like most of us? We need some gaps. And Lord knows I'm seeing something going on right now. I hope we can get some policemen instead of Wake County, instead of Pitt County, to stay inside community policing, and some of the teachers' assistants. Let them come downtown. A couple of charter schools right straight on the way. So Mr. Mayor, I congratulate you on this idea. It's excellent. And I hope some of the rest of the folk will positively say, let's move ahead. We got smart people making good money at the Durham staff. Talk about they need 6 months, 8 months, 9 months. We're not rushing anything. It's late doing it, coming up with this kind of program. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to come down here. I don't come often, but this one is important. And I wanted to just watch the faces of the conversations going on while the mayor's talking. Thank you very much.
Welcome. Is there anyone else who wants to speak on this item? This is not a public.
James Chavis.
My name is James Chavis. I stay 2813 Ash Street in Durham.
the volume, we don't agree on much. But one thing I do have to say, I watched those three faces too. And it's a shame and disgrace, Mayor Bell, how they disrespect you. Okay? You can disagree, but while he's talking, I never see him talking to anyone else. He's sitting back listening. But you three, y'all sit there and ran y'all mouth with each other, grinning and sneering. Well, what'd they say to us? Three blacks, one, two, three, so to three whites. That's segregation right there. That's what? Showing to the people out front how you all do not respect. And you know, I don't go with everything Mel says, okay? But y'all supposed to be colleagues. And one thing y'all have done tonight has been very disrespectful to him. Thank you.
If it's no one else that wants to speak on this item, I'm going to move. Is this young lady gonna have to speak or you leave? Okay, thank you. I'm going to move back to the council and recognize whoever wants to speak on this item. Recognize Councilman Shuler.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So a couple of the reasons that I, so let me just say, I do support this, and I have said already that I support this, and will be planning to vote for the recommendation that we've added this to the scope of work of the consultant, and I agree with that. The question here is not whether or not we're adding it to the scope of work, or at least the way I understand it from everybody's position, but exactly how long it's going to take to study it. And so, you know, I think about, let me just give an example of why it might take longer. I think that we think about what we did in Southside, and we think about what we did on South Street. And I think that I can tell you that I'm disappointed, and I think many of us are disappointed, that that neighborhood has not become a diverse neighborhood. We put a whole lot of city money into it, a lot of federal money into it, and we've got a neighborhood that it's disappointing to me because it is largely a white neighborhood. And I think that studying it, trying to get it right, to figure out what the right price points are, and to try to figure out how to increase that diversity is super important. And I think that a reasonable amount of time to get that right makes sense. So it's not, I just want to be clear. The speaker said we need to support the mayor's program here. I'm planning to vote for it. I'm just planning to vote for it, and the staff's recommendation that it should take 150 days instead of 90 days, and plan to do that. Thank you.
Recognize Councilman Mark.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I realize that I have four questions, really, that matter to me. How much does a program like this cost? How long will it cost that? What is the impact of the program overall? And what are we trading off to do that? So if there are 50 families that will get no service from the city because we've subsidized 50 families when we could have helped 100, that's an important trade-off to me. And those are the questions that I have, that I would have about any program, that none of which we know yet, and which hopefully the consultants can help us with, and then we'll have something that we can talk about in the details. How much does it cost? How long will it cost it? What's the impact? What's the trade-off? Thank you.
Are there other questions or comments? I've shared my recognize the mayor pro tem.
I would like to know how much time would this have taken had we not asked for the add-on? Maybe you said it, but we've been intellectualizing so long.
So the entire scope of the task is from September 1st start to mid-February.
Is that because you added some on?
No, ma'am.
What was it before that?
It was September 1st to mid-February.
Okay.
Any other questions? And let me say again, taking in consideration the comments that have been made, we make a decision. However the decision comes out, we move on. I would expect the same thing to happen on this particular item. So again, since I've raised a question, I would entertain a motion to accept the consultant's recommendation, but to have the target move to the end of December rather than what's being proposed. That's the motion I would accept.
I so move.
And if there's a second to the motion, it's been properly moved and second. There's discussion on the question. Recognize Councilman Moffitt.
Yes, I'm not sure I quite understood. Are we saying that we're willing to accept the contract if the completion of task three can be completed by December 31st?
Yes, that's it.
So that would be up to the consultant then to just either withdraw task three or the entire, okay.
And I think it's fair to ask the consultant, is that doable? I think it's fair to ask that question because that's where it is. Given the conversation we've had, and I've heard you say that it only takes 7 hours to do the piece that I had a question about, but you haven't told us what the total piece is. But I think it's fair to ask that question.
One further question. Given what you said earlier, I need to ask, did you mean the end of December or did you mean the end of November? I think we'll seat new council members first meeting in December.
I said the end of December, and I understand that new council persons will come in. I appreciate that.
Okay. Because now we're talking 2 weeks difference, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think we would be comfortable with agreeing to December 31st. On behalf of Enterprise, I think we would be comfortable to agreeing to the completion of task three by December 31st.
Are there further questions or discussions? Recognize Councilman Shule.
So that means December 31st instead of January 15th, that's what we're talking about?
That's correct.
So, okay.
Are there further discussions? If not, I'm going to call the question. The question is to accept the contract with the modification on task three to be completed by no later than December 31st. If they can complete it before that, that's fine, but no later than December 31st. And other part of the contract would stand as it is. Is there further discussion on that? If not, I'm going to call the question. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Will you close the vote?
It passes 7-0.
All right, thank you. To the next item, please. Item 19, the crime report.
Mr. Mayor, Mayor Pro Tem, Council, Mr. Manager, Mr. Attorney, I'm here to present the Police Department's 2015 second quarter report, which covers the first 6 months of the year. The quarterly report covers our department's six performance measures: violent crime, property crime, part one, index crime, clearance rates, response times for priority one calls, and staffing levels. The executive summary includes other and significant events during the second quarter. Part one, violent crime, was up by 13.5% in the first 6 months of 2015 compared to the first 6 months of 2014. The rise in violent crime was driven by an increase in the number of aggravated assaults, robberies, and homicides. During the first quarter, we started a 90-day initiative to target gun violence. This initiative continued into portion of the second quarter. The final results are included in the executive summary. We've continued to gather available intelligence about shootings and to focus on areas where the shootings have occurred. In April, Crime Stoppers and Project Safe Neighborhoods started a Gun Stoppers initiative. The initiative focused on soliciting information about illegal firearms in the community, such as those possessed by felons and those used in crimes.
Crime Stoppers will pay up to $500 cash for information leading to a felony arrest and recovery of an illegal gun in Durham. Each month, officers and community volunteers go door to door, speaking to residents and passing out information in areas which had the most gun violence in the previous month. Although there were 16 homicides and one fatal self-defense shooting reported during the first 6 months of 2015, 13 of the 16 homicides have been cleared by arrest. One of the homicides is a case in which a victim was shot in 2011, but died as a result of his injuries this year. So far this year, we've had 20 homicides, 17 cleared. We also had 6 cold cases from prior years, which have been cleared so far this year. There was a double homicide on Dawkins Street, cleared from 2012. We had one homicide from 2013, and 3 homicides, which had occurred in 2014. Reported sexual assaults were at a 3-year low during the first 6 months of 2015. The number of robberies increased, but investigators made several arrests during the second quarter. On April 29, officers arrested 6 people on armed robbery charges. Members of this group were charged with committing a dozen armed robberies during April. Property crime was up by 3% during the first 6 months of 2015. The rise was caused by increases in reported larcenies, which make up more than half of all reported Part 1 crimes. Investigators from our departments continue to work with investigators from other area departments to focus on shoplifting, which accounts for a significant percentage of our larcenies. There have also been increases in larcenies from vehicles and also from buildings. We have continued our residential awareness program, which focuses on residential burglaries. Our burglaries were down during the first half of this year. We continue to urge people to dial 911 to report suspicious activity. These calls often help officers make arrests, especially for property crimes. Our community resource officers have been encouraging people to take practical steps to avoid being a victim of property crime. For example, don't leave valuable items in plain view in your vehicles, and secure items such as bicycles and lawn equipment. Part 1 index crime was up 5% during the first half of 2015 compared to the same period in 2014. Reported crime was down in 2 Part 1 categories, that was rapes and burglaries. Clearance rates for homicides, robberies, larceny, and motor vehicle thefts were above the FBI national average clearance rates for cities our size. The average response time to priority 1 calls during the first 6 months was 6.2 minutes, which did not meet our target average of 5.8 minutes. 51% of priority 1 calls were answered in under 5 minutes during the first 6 months. That did not meet the target of 57%. Our sworn positions are currently fully staffed. This includes 25 recruits who graduated on August 3rd from the basic law enforcement training, class number 41 academy. The BLET 42 academy with 14 Durham Police Department recruits started on August 10th. There were 8 non-sworn vacancies at the end of the second quarter. To end this presentation, I would like to share some photos of our successful 2015 National Night Out celebration. More than 100 neighborhoods and businesses participated on August 4th. You can view more photos on our Facebook page. Thank you very much.
You're welcome, Chief. Let me ask first, are there comments or questions that council members have on the report? Recognize Councilman Shule.
Mayor, Chief, thank you for the report. In your one of the things you had in your in the report that we received, the materials among the Human Relations Commission recommendation was the residency initiative programs. People have already talked a little bit tonight about our hope that we'll have more of our officers living here in Durham. And I was wondering, and I believe that it was the reference was that there are ongoing ideas about some residency incentive programs, and I wondered and where are we on that? Do we, have we made any progress? Do we have any concrete ideas?
Councilman Shue, if I could interrupt, apologize.
Yes, sir.
Most of that work we're doing out of the HR department,
okay,
not necessarily out of the police department. We'll do it in conjunction with the police department.
Okay.
But we want to conduct some surveys this fall of officers that are currently on staff, and we'll be following up on
okay,
that.
Great.
I'll be glad to follow up with you.
Thank you, Mr. Manager. Chief, and then my next question, where are we on the body cameras? What's our timetable now?
I wouldn't be able to give you a timetable. We're going to be doing it as soon as possible, meaning that right now we do have, we're looking to see which ones we're going to buy. And we have a request out at this point. So we're looking in the very near future to at least start outfitting officers with the body cameras. We're putting together we're just about completed the policy in reference to it. So we'll be rolling that out soon.
Great. And I know one of the concerns some of the concerns that were raised and were talked about during the public hearings that you had, public hearings, they were the meetings that you had with the public, had to do with some of the privacy issues. And I know that, for example, the one I was at, Chief Marsh described some of the potential issues that can arise with the camera's privacy issues and so forth. And I'm sure you all are thinking those through very carefully.
Chief Marsh has been doing an excellent job putting that together, and he's apparently leaving no stone unturned. The amount of material that he has read just on this subject alone is unbelievable, and I'm pretty sure it'll be addressed as best as possible.
Great. And then I was glad to see that you all have finished the fair and impartial policing training has now been given to all the officers in the department, which I thought was excellent achievement and done very quickly, and appreciate the initiative y'all have taken on that. And also, I was glad to see the misdemeanor diversion program, that the plans to extend that to age 21. And so I know that's not just an initiative of yours, but also the mayor's and other organizations around the city. But
I'm certain you'll be very pleased in the very near future as we roll that out.
Great.
And to speak to the fair and unbiased training.
Yes, sir.
We also have other police departments that are coming to us now to see if we can train their departments in reference to it.
Great. And I was appreciative of the recruiting statistics. It definitely, I appreciate it. It looks like you really are making a good effort at getting minority applicants. I noticed that this last time there were 33 African-American applicants versus 24 white applicants. And so, again, I know that the department makes a good effort at this recruitment, and I just want to say that it's much appreciated.
Well, if I could give you the 41 BLT, yeah, BLET breakdown for the last officers who just graduated, we have one Latina female, three Latino males, three African-American males, 18 whites. And for the 12 that we have right now, we have three African-American males, one African-American female, two Asian males, one Latin male, seven white males, and then we have three recruits who speak Spanish.
Great. Thank you, Chief. The aggravated assaults continue to be, I mean, I think when you look at the numbers, they continue to be the thing that seems to be really driving the increase. And you all have commented to us before about that, and I was wondering if you wanted to make any more comments tonight about how we're trying to deal with that, because that is definitely, when you look at the numbers, that's what's really pushing everything up.
And we're addressing that extremely aggressively. We're looking at all the numbers. We're sitting down and looking for the available intelligence. We're working with the community to the extent that we have our initiative where these officers and these volunteers from the community are actually going door to door in places where we know we have had a high incidence of shootings. I think a lot of that's going to make a difference as far as getting the information that we need in order to identify these few individuals that are causing all this.
Great. And how did you all feel about the results of the 90-day initiative that you described and that we've heard from previously about from you and Chief Smith in terms of its results in Cornwallis and McDougal Terrace areas? Did you feel did it have the kind of positive results that you were hoping for?
I think it has. I think it's been a lot quieter, but also more importantly, I think we've gotten a lot better results from the community as far as trust and partnerships.
And I just wanted to mention there were description of several officers having to respond to calls where there had been shooting. And I just wanted to mention I know we all recognize the courage that takes to walk into that situation, and I did want to just say to the you and the members of the department, that that's very much appreciated by everyone in Durham, the courage to do that. One of the things that was mentioned was the event led by the D.L. Forbes Youth Foundation in April, which I did attend, and I would say there were maybe 100 people there, a lot of them very young. And I just want to say that I thought that that was a fabulous event. The role-playing was super intense and very realistic, and it really, I think, for a grown-up like me, but for a young person as well, I just thought it was a tremendous educational tool, and so I hope you'll pass that on. And I also noticed one other thing I want to mention. Officers Armstrong and Kramer were cited for their use of life-saving tourniquets, and I just thought it was very impressive, not only that they saved these lives, but that in particular Officer Armstrong was cited for pushing this initiative into the department, and that the department has picked up on this and made the equipment and training widely available. So again, I wanted to say to our command staff that this is a great, this is a real tribute, and I appreciate it. And then finally, I just, the clearance rates are down from where they have been, and I wondered if you had anything to offer on that. Is that related to the aggravated assaults, or are there any other factors that have been making those clearance rates?
I think as we continue to move forward, getting the trust from this community, that clearance rates will go up, and I think a large factor will be the cooperation from the community, and I think that's very much important.
Okay. Thank you, Chief.
Thank you, Councilman Shule. Recognize Councilman Brown, and then the Mayor Pro Tem.
Thank you, but Chief, what is the, I'm harking back to our rather lengthy discussion about the rental program that obviously you heard. What is the starting salary of salary for police officers?
At the academy, they're at $33,000, and when they graduate, I believe they're at $36,000. Do I have that about right? Up and down, somewhere in that in that range. So and then, of course, as time goes on, depending on your promotions, your raises.
So they would be able, I think, to qualify for this rental assistance program.
Any assistance you can give them would be just fine, I think.
Right.
But I think that if you're looking at living downtown, I think they definitely would need some assistance.
I'm sorry?
I think if they're looking to live downtown, they would need some assistance.
Oh, yeah.
Especially if we're looking at the numbers that I heard thrown around.
Pretty high. What percentage of the Durham police force lives in the city of Durham?
I don't have that number for you, but I can make it available for you.
Yeah, because I've heard that, unfortunately, it's rather small.
I would have to get that number to you. I would be able. I'll tell you that I live in Durham.
We know that.
Yes,
that was a requirement, I think. If you can get back to us sooner than later on that.
Okay, we can get you that information.
Because I think it's important for the majority of our officers to live in the city in which they serve. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilman Brown. Recognize the Mayor Pro Tem.
Good evening, and thank you for that report and the work that your team is doing. Normally, I come to all of the academy graduations. I was a bit disappointed this time that it was on a city council meeting night. Please, please don't deprive us of that opportunity, because they need to see us and know that we support their work.
Well, we've had that discussion. So.
Thank you very much.
Are there any comments?
Can you make a promise then? I'll ask the manager.
As long as I'm chief of police.
Are there any other comments for the chief? If not, chief, thank you for the report.
Thank you very much.
We move to item 20, 2014 evaluation assessment report.
Good evening, I'm Carla Rosenberg with the Planning Department. I can certify that notification for the public hearing item before you from the Planning Department tonight has been properly noticed as required by state and local law. So before you is Plan Amendment Case 15-00001, the 2014 Annual Evaluation and Assessment Report, or EAR, of the Durham Comprehensive Plan. This document allows the city and county to evaluate progress over the past year in implementing the plan and its objectives. Included in the EAR are proposed policy changes and rectification of any differences between the city and county versions of the future land use map. The plan amendment requiring rectification is A130009, Village of Rougemont. We have additionally updated the recreation and open space and agricultural layers of the future land use map and have included a section on planning trends and issues. Staff recommends approval of this application. The Planning Commission recommended approval on May 12, 2014 with a vote to 11-0, and the Board of County Commissioners approved on August 10, 2015 with a vote of 5-0. Please let me know if you have any questions.
You've heard the staff report. Are there questions on the staff on this item? Oh, recognize Councilman Shaw.
Just have a quick comment, which is I really thought that the trend analysis in the memo was really interesting, Ms. Rosenberg, and the I was really appreciative of that, and the policy implementation highlights I thought showed a tremendous amount of work by all of our departments to meet the planning objectives, and so it was just a really interesting document to read and appreciate.
Thank you.
Any other comments? If not, entertain a motion. Oh, wait a minute. I'm sorry. This is a public hearing. Is anyone else in the public that wants to speak on this item? If not, let the record reflect no one else has to speak. I declare the public hearing closed. This matter is back before the council.
Move the item.
Second. It's been properly moved and seconded. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? And close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. We move to item 21, public hearing to consider ordering completion of streets and portions of Ravenstone and Stone Hill Estates subdivisions. And while the staff is coming forth to present that, I have two persons that have signed up to speak. Is there anyone else that wants to speak on this item? This is a public hearing. If so, if you could go to the clerk's desk and sign up. All right. Thank you. We're open to public hearing with staff comments.
Good evening, Mayor Bell, members of the council. I'm Robert Joyner, Development Review Group Manager. Item 21 is to consider the ordering of the completion of streets and portions of Ravenstone and Stonehill Estates subdivisions under the Enabling Act authority. The proposed projects are inside the city limits. Staff recommends that council adopt a preliminary resolution, conduct a public hearing, and adopt a final resolution to order each of the projects. Be happy to answer any questions council may have. And I'd also like to state that the advertisement for this public hearing to consider these proposed improvements was published in the August 7th edition of the Durham Herald Sun, as well as individually mailed notifications via U.S. mail.
Thank you. You've heard the staff report. Let me ask first other questions of members of the council on the staff report. I recognize Councilman Moffitt.
The preliminary resolution, has that already been adopted?
It has not. It would be a part of this order. So you'd adopt a preliminary resolution and then a final resolution, sir.
All at the same time?
Yes.
Thank you.
I mean, all in the same meeting. Is that
yeah,
the point?
All in the same meeting. I apologize.
Okay. All right. Thank you. I recognize Councilman Brown.
Yes. Could you give us, because I know we discussed this, what the average monthly payment would be for the average homeowner in this district?
So the ordering of this, yes sir, the ordering of this improvements is for the street. So the numbers that I'd be talking about would actually be the combined totals for the streets and stormwater. So for Stonehill Estates, the current engineering estimate would be $2,531. And for Ravenstone, it would be $2,701. And again, that is the combined streets and stormwater estimated cost.
And that's the total cost.
And that's the total cost. The yes, time period would be 10 years, no interest.
And so the monthly fee would be an average of what for the two subdivisions?
Bear with me just a second, sir.
We should have that. Ain't much.
$21.09 for Stone Hill Estates.
Get that, Jim?
$21.
Okay. $21.09. And $22.51 for Ravenstone.
Thank you. I just think it's important for all of us to understand that, listening audience as well. Thank you.
Are there other, recognize Councilman Moffitt.
Yes, sir, I just want to confirm then, the 2,500, the 2,700 numbers you cited, that's for the, that's half of the total cost. That's the 50% of the cost that each average home would be assessed.
That is correct, sir.
Thank you.
Are there any other questions before we go to the public? If not, I recognize James O. Williams and Gwen Silver. Is there someone else? And one other person. So, William, you have 3 minutes initially on this.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. James O. Williams, 102 Citrine Court, Durham, North Carolina. I'd like to say hello to Mayor Bell, Mayor Tim, and to the City Council. I'm going on my ninth year in Stonehill. I've been dealing with these streets ever since, and I haven't missed a moment in the last 8 years of being down here. The situation is, originally, I must say, the City of Durham dropped the ball. Within the last, 30 days, the streets have been remarked. Manhole covers have been, filled in. I understand that we will not be able to get the work done on the streets until June of 2016. At that point, the cost is going to escalate. Who's going to pay the bill? I'm looking at my homeowner's taxes. My taxes are going up, but my property value is going down because the streets haven't been completed. I got to look at heavy equipment coming through the neighborhood where they have filled in. All that's going to be torn up between now and next year. So who's going to pay for that? We get no city services as it stands. The snow, neighbors have to get out there and do their own thing to get up and down and out of the neighborhood. So where do we stand at this point? The 50-50 deal that we're talking, I really don't think it's fair, but as it stands, look like I'm stuck with it. So where do we go from here? I'd like to know.
So when you've been down here, as you said, and I appreciate the fact that you've followed this, and I'm going to leave it to the staff to try to respond to the question. Let the city manager want to respond.
Well, Mr. Williams raised a number of issues that might have different answer for different questions. When you say city services, I don't know if we're talking about just snow removal, or are we talking about
sweeping the streets themselves? Okay, that's one thing. Snow removal is another thing, and just generally coming through to check the neighborhood. Let's say, for instance, storm drains having leaves down in them and water not being able to flow. The city doesn't come out to remove the leaves out of the storm drains. That's another problem.
So one of the questions that I've asked the city attorney to help us understand is at what point the assets, both the streets and stormwater assets, do become the responsibility of the city, and how we transition those assets to the city ownership. Since I'm not clear who exactly owns them now, that will certainly be a question that we'll have to deal with. But I think, as you've seen already with the street work that's been done, we're trying to be proactive and come out and do some things that maybe we don't legally have the authority or have to do because we don't own those streets. So I assure you that along the way, over the next several months, as we move forward, we will respond to concerns that you have that get raised as we try to work through the details of how we transition the ownership of the public assets of the streets and stormwater. Now, the question about the additional cost, Mr. Joyner may want to address, just for the record, the process about what happens going forward once the council adopts a resolution and the work is scheduled and the costs are actually calculated, and how any of the final calculations run. But other than that, in terms of the day-to-day services, if there are particular issues, I would ask you to to call us, and we'll do everything we can to try to respond to them.
Yeah, because I look at it, I live at the intersection of Citrine Court and Lodestone. The city trucks come down, sweep the streets. When it gets down to Citrine Court, they make a U-turn and go back. And which I can understand, with the manhole covers being up, say, this high, tearing up the equipment is something the city would have to worry about there, and along with the person operating the equipment to explain to his boss what happened. And I do understand that. But, my concern is, where do we go from here, shall I say? Everybody looks muffled.
Mr. Williams.
Yes.
So moving forward, the city had worked on advertising for the work. And so the city recently, about a week and a half ago, held the final bids. And at that time, they did not receive the appropriate number of bidders to open those bids under state law. And so there needed to be three bidders. There was basically one. And so at that point, the city has to go forth and re-advertise. Now the problem that we're running into is the ability to do the work has now been condensed, because you have to re-advertise everything, go back out, hold additional public comment period, and that squeezes down your construction timeline against the winter when you can viably do those types of things. And so at that point, the Public Works Department has recommended that this item be rebid and that the work be completed in the summer to allow for an appropriate time frame to construct the improvements.
Okay, rebidding itself, at this point you had given them what, 45 days, I do believe?
I believe that was the approximate length of the time to construct.
Okay. At the next bid, can it be extended? Because if you only got one bid this time, Lord knows what's going to happen the next time.
Marvin Williams, Public Works. So essentially, now that we're rebidding the project, we may have a little bit more flexibility under state law. If we made multiple attempts to rebid the work and we are unsuccessful in getting more than one bidder, at that point we can talk to the city attorney's office to review any appropriate contracting laws to see if we can go with the one bid that's submitted. But we would caution the council, if there is only one bid, the prices may be above what we've initially estimated for the project. And that will be another discussion point that we have to bring through the city manager to decide if the costs increase have gone beyond what we initially presented to you over the summer, how the council would like for us to proceed with the work.
Are there Councilman Davis?
Yes, Mr. Mayor. I'm assuming that the price that we've quoted to the residents here would stay the same, even though the city may have to encounter more outlay, that we have committed to making this quote, or are we committed to the half that is a part of what we have here on our form? Which of the two takes precedence?
And that'll be a decision the council will have to make at the time.
Well,
once we know the final number.
Sure. Well, I'd like to lean in favor of the commitment that we made to them at this point already.
I recognize the Mayor Pro Tem.
Mr. Williams, we're going to take some of the money out of the stormwater fund anyway, right? We have an excess amount of money.
That's a separate item that will be coming under a separate public hearing.
Okay,
right now, right. We're really focused on the streets. There will be a separate public hearing for the stormwater improvements that need to be made. And at that point, the council can direct us with how we should proceed with.
Okay, so we're not even going to deal with that part. Okay.
Mm. Are there other questions by council members? Because we do have other speakers. Mr. Williams, had you finished with your questions?
Well, one question I did ask, my tax rate is going up, but the value on my home is depreciating.
Let me be clear about the tax rate, at least for the city. I can't speak for the county.
Mm-hmm.
For the city, we've set the tax rate for the city and it didn't go up.
Oh, you're saying it didn't go up?
No.
I beg the difference, because I looked at it today.
The tax rate for the city did not go up. Now, I can't speak for the county.
Oh, okay. You can't speak for the county itself.
Yeah.
But I'm looking
at the city didn't raise its tax.
I'm just looking at with the streets being what they are. You know, the value of my home is not worth what it was when I paid for it 9 years ago.
Well, let me say, because I asked that question also. My question was, when the county does this evaluation, and again, the county sets the value of your house, not the city.
Mm-hmm.
When the county, I say your house, the property, the county does that. My question was, when the county does the evaluation, does it take in consideration the streets that are in the neighborhood, or is it just looking at the property itself? And I recall, I think, Mr. Manager, that the answer was, it does not impact the value of the house. Now, if that's not the case, we need to go back to the county and try to understand that.
And just for the record, revaluation is going on right now, so we'll start knowing later this fall what some of those projections are. But again, I'm not, don't want to speak for the county, but from what I understand, most of the valuation is done by sales, comparable sales, not by the condition of the street. So depending on ultimately what the sales comps are in your neighborhood, that's what's going to be the biggest driver in terms of what your new tax value is once revaluation takes place at the end of the year.
I understand what you're saying, but I'm just looking at homes being sold in the area for well below the market value at this point. Okay.
Well, in that case, it would bid well for you, because it means that the value of your house, taxable value, would be less, and therefore
It should be less.
Okay, but you know where you take that up with, and I'm not being facetious.
With the county.
With the county.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. That's all I have at this point. Greatly appreciate it. Thank you very much.
Quite welcome. Let me recognize Gwen Silver.
Good evening, Mayor Bell, Mayor Pro Tem, members of the City Council, and city administrators. I support the completion of the streets, and I also support the City Council making up the difference between what they've approved if the streets are deteriorating over the winter months. But I also want you to reconsider the 50-50 and pay an additional amount of perhaps residents pay 10% and you pay 90% of the bill. In addition to that, I heard the discussion about affordable housing. I think those of us who purchased, bought homes that we could afford, I do not support the affordable housing for downtown. I think it's not going to be sustainable, and I think that long term it's going to be something that the city is not going to be able to basically provide, and we don't know who's going to be coming. The train for actually working on affordable housing left 10 years ago, and that was when West Village was renovated. We're far behind the ball, and I don't think that we're going to really be able to keep catch up in order for it to be a diverse downtown as we need it to be. Thank you.
You're welcome. Ryan Lanier, I can't read this last name. Lancy?
Yeah.
I apologize.
Good evening, Your Honors, members of the council. I've been up here a few times now. I'm the president of the Ravenstone Homeowners Association. You should have received from me a formal written objection to moving forward with this action on behalf of the homeowners in our neighborhood. I do want to agree with the member from the Stonehill Board that talked about the housing subsidies. The city wants to spend $600 a month to subsidize the rent of people that it feels are more desirable to have downtown than me in my neighborhood. The $600 per household in our neighborhood would be cover the cost in 4 months. So I don't really think that's fair at all, because we already live in Durham. And since we're, as the other member of the board from the other neighborhood mentioned, we're already paying into services that we're not receiving. So we're subsidizing a great deal of the work that the city is presently doing. We are, sorry, I have a cold. We are not getting bids on the work because you spent an hour today berating the consultant from the affordable housing group. People don't want to work with the city when you stand them up here for an hour and nitpick everything that they do in their proposal. The other thing is that, you know, this is just not right. You know, core infrastructure, you know, police service, fire service, EMS, roads, that's what the city needs to be worrying about, okay? Not, you know, how do we make a certain demographic live in a certain neighborhood, you know? That's what the market will dictate. Whatever the market will bear is what rent is going to be. If people want to live in a certain neighborhood because they're Hispanic or they're black or they're white, they're going to live where they want to live. And you guys shouldn't be worrying about that. You should be worrying about fixing the roads and neighborhoods for people that are already paying taxes, that already live in your city. Thank you.
Welcome, and I appreciate your comments, but I can tell you that this council worries about all the things that you spoke about, and it hasn't changed and will not change on that. I'm going to recognize, I apologize, I haven't, can you recognize that name? No, I can read your name. So why don't you come on up then? Right. I'll let the city attorney read the other name.
How do you pronounce it? Good evening, everyone. I also live in the Ravenstone subdivision. My wife and I are first-time homeowners. We purchased our house going on 2 years ago now. We're very excited. We have a lot of things to consider because it's kind of a starter home. You know, we want to raise a family here in Durham. I went to North Carolina Central. We're kind of rooted in the community. We have opportunities to move away, but we've been dying to stay. Things of this nature where you make a decision to charge us, to fix what seems pretty simple, roads in our community, to get us back and forth and to do different things, make it a challenge for us to do that. So when we consider our next home purchase, we will remember the decisions made today and going forward on how much Durham is supporting our family. So just my piece.
Call it in.
Is there an M.D. Jaleel?
Dear respected mayor and council member, thank you for giving me the opportunity. Actually, I bought this house this year in last year, in Ravenstone. But as per the homeowner's disclosure statement, I see, and I already talked with Mr. Engineer, Mr. Joyner, and he said is as per this disclosure statement, it's a proposed assessment or something, but they checked is no. But am I liable to pay for this new assessment for improvement or anything and something like that? So would you please consider for me? That's my question is. Thank you.
You're welcome. Is there anyone else that wants to speak on this item? Again, this is a public hearing in any form or fashion. Let the record reflect that no one else asked to speak on this item. I will declare the public hearing to be closed and matters back before the council. It's been properly moved and second. Recognize Councilman Moffitt for comment.
I think that this item has been before us for a long time. This has been a real issue to these homeowners. We need to get these roads completed on a timely basis. I understand why now that the lack of bids has impacted the timetable, but I'm hoping that we can move this forward as quickly as possible.
I fully understand the concerns that the residents have raised. There's no question about that. The city did some things that it should not have done, and I appreciate that also. Unfortunately, we still have a process that we have to go through, and it probably isn't agreeable to those that are being impacted, but we're trying to do the best we can to right as much of a wrong that occurred. I would tend to favor keeping the prices of what we have now, no matter what the bids come in with, unless they come in lower. But we'll make that decision at the appropriate time. Any other questions on this item? If not, I'm going to call the question. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
And do we have to open the public hearing or continue to open another public hearing for this other resolution or what?
You need to adopt the final resolution.
Okay. It's been properly moved and seconded. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? You close the vote. It was moved by the Mayor Pro Tem and seconded by Councilman Brown.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. Okay, is anything else to come before the council? I'm sorry, item 24, which was added onto it, resolution in opposition of redistribution of local sales tax. And, say what? No, this was added. Item 4. It's been properly moved and seconded. Madam Clerk, any questions? Hearing none. Madam questions? Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? And close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
All right. Thank you. Any other items to come before the council? Yes, sir. I recognize Councilman Brown.
I didn't hear it.
Yes, for the special council meeting, I'd like an excused absence, please. No, one.
Special council meeting and the work session.
Oh, both.
I move with reluctance that we.
Well, don't say that for Jane, because I got a request too. Go ahead.
Okay.
But let's move on his
okay.
First.
I move that we excuse Mr. Brown.
Can you open the vote? And close the vote.
Passes 7-0.
I'm going to ask for excuse absence from the work session also. I've got an issue that I have to be at my office. On that day.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Any other items to come before the council? If not, the council is adjourned at 9:07 p.m. Thank you.